So, this is the last in a series of sermons on the book of Job. What fun! This morning, we're talking about the happy ending. Everybody loves a happy ending, which is why we know it was a later addition to the book of Job. The book of Job does not end where it was originally written to end. You remember the story. Job lost his entire life. It was taken away from him. He was reduced to sitting in the ashes of a fire, scraping his sores with pottery. His three friends had preached forever about how God was fair, and therefore he deserved what had happened to him ad infinitum. When all of a sudden God speaks out of a whirlwind. After the Lord had spoken these words to Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, "My wrath is kindled against you and against your two friends, for you've not spoken of me what's right, as your servant Job has. Now therefore take seven bulls and seven rams, and go to my servant Job, and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering. And my servant Job shall pray for you. For I will accept his prayer not to deal with you according to your folly, for you've not spoken of me what's right, as my servant Job has." So Eliphaz the Temanite and Bildad the Shuhite and Zophar the Naamathite went and did what the Lord had told them, and the Lord accepted Job's prayer. That is where the story was supposed to end. It ends with Job not knowing why this had happened. It ended without Job being restored. It ended with him in agony and misery, destitute. But somebody couldn't stand it. Somebody at some point decided this story needs a happy ending. Job deserves better than he got. So they added verses 10 through 17. And the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then there came to him all his brothers and sisters and all who had known him before, and they ate bread with him in the house. They showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. And each of them gave him a piece of money and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning. And he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, 1,000 donkeys. He also had seven sons and three daughters. He named the first Jemima, and you thought that was only a name for maple syrup. The second Keziah, and the third Karen Happich. In all the land there were no women as so beautiful as Job's daughters. And their father gave them an inheritance among their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years, saw his children and his children's children four generations, and Job died old and full of days. Isn't that great? Doesn't it make you feel better, that last little section, to know that God restored the fortunes of Job? So, cutting out an entire page, but who needs it?
Evidently, here ends the story of Job.
Did you hear about the preacher that stood up and said, "Gee, I'm real sorry, but my dog ate half the sermon"? Somebody raised their hand and said, "Preachers, that dog had any puppies." One of the most curious sentences in this happy ending is verse 11. Then there came to him all his brothers and sisters and all who had known him before. Where had these people been? And they ate bread with him in his house. They showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. and each of them gave him a piece of money and a gold ring. Well, isn't that sweet? The verse that really stands out to me is, "And they comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him."
What's with that?
Did you hear it? They just dropped all of Job's suffering at the feet of God. They just dropped all of our suffering at the feet of God. Wow. Is that where it belongs? Well, think about it for a minute. If we believe that God is all-powerful, and if we believe that God could stop all suffering in the world, then who's responsible for not stopping it? Those are interesting propositions. Would you let me know when you figure out how to test them? Because I'm not sure that they're all correct. But what I find so absolutely interesting is human nature. We really like the idea that Job got his just reward. We really like that idea that God restored Job's fortune, made him rich again, and gave him beautiful children. We still don't know where Mrs. Job was. We really like that idea that God is fair, that life is fair, that people get what they deserve, even though we know it isn't true. I wish you could have known Wheeler. Lawrence Wheeler was the custodian at the church in Lebanon. He was an absolutely fine Christian man. Terrible custodian, but a fine He could not see dust. He kept mowing over the flowers in the garden. But as good a Christian man as you'll ever meet, generous, kind, welcoming, a wonderful man. And then he got liver cancer and died. A terrible, horrible death. Did he get what he deserved? Was his cancer sent to him as a punishment? No. You know what really bothers me in this whole entire discussion? You and I are a people of grace. We know that we were born forgiven by God. God has nothing to punish us for. Our sins are forgiven. God wouldn't punish someone who's forgiven. Right? Forgiven. We stand clean and pure before our God. You know, that's an amazing thing to consider. Because you and I will not ever know the why of our suffering. We will keep asking the question, and we must. We must keep asking the question of why do we suffer, even though we will never have an answer. And even though we know that every answer to the question is wrong. But still, we have to cling to the love of God for each one of us. God is not absent. God has not abandoned us. God is not punishing us. God is not angry. God is love. That's what I cling to. Hey, I took this survey in the 9 o'clock service. I want to take it again. So how many of you have a tattoo? There we go. Well, I have been late to the party. I've not gotten one. My problem is that I couldn't figure out what I wanted written, drawn on my body forever that was unerasable. There's a guy at the gym that's got a picture of his wife tattooed on his chest. That's great, but they've been divorced 25 years. Every morning he sees his ex in the mirror. But I have figured out what I want tattooed. It's these ending verses from Romans 8. They're my absolute favorite verses in the Bible, where Paul is struggling with the issue of suffering and Christians dying. Because God's love, right? And God's all present. Then why do Christians suffer? Why does anybody suffer? What then are we to say about these things? If God's for us, then who can be against us? He who didn't withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring charges against God's elect? Who will claim that I'm a sinner in need of punishment? It's God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It's Jesus, Christ Jesus, who died. Yes, who was raised, who's at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Isn't that the most beautiful metaphor? That there's God sitting on the throne, and there's Jesus at the right hand saying, you see Larry down there? He's really doing the best he can. He really is God. Huh. Beautiful metaphor. Here comes my favorite part. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing will ever be able to separate us from the love of God. We are people of grace. We'll not understand our suffering, but we will understand that God, who is love, is with us. May we pray? God, to live is to experience suffering at least sometimes. We will always ask why and wonder why it was us. Help us, God, to cling to that question. And help us, God, to cling to your love, believing that no matter what happens, you love us. We're your children. We pray in the name of Christ. Amen.